Good to know you're still with us. Now, the federal government, in a person, let's say via Lai Mohammed, has said that the Minister of Information has admitted that members of the Boko Haram sect and ISWAP are targeting Christians and Christian communities in a bid to trigger what he says is a religious war and throw the nation into chaos. Now, previously, President Muhammadu Buhari had said that it was not true that Christians were the primary targets of Boko Haram. Who do we believe? Still with me in the studio, we have Lolu, Elegbe. Thank you for staying with us. And we have Olalekan, Adigun. Pleasure to have you join us. Now, let me start with you, Olalekan. Is this new information for you? This one, on the one hand, Christians are being targeted. On the other hand, no, Christians are not being targeted.
Felicity, I will not want to succumb to some of these things I see on the media, particularly information coming out from Boko Haram. We need to be very, very careful at this point. We are dealing with the Islamic State of West African province at this point. And we need to be very, very careful about what we put out as information, because if this takes religious dimension, it becomes very, very difficult to handle, because that is exactly what ISWAP wants, to make it look like.
But isn't it a religious battle in the first instance? Because what we know Boko Haram to be, they came out and they said that they want to make Nigeria an Islamic nation. But has that changed since then?
That is why we should not succumb to Boko Haram propaganda, because we have seen in situations where even Boko Haram even attack mosques, for like we saw in Adamawa in 2018, do you understand, one of the largest mosques in Mubi were bombed by members of the Boko Haram sect. So I don't want to believe there was the idea that Boko Haram is trying to establish an Islamic state in Nigeria, so that we should not fall into the propaganda of the ISWAP, where we want to make, they want to make it look like it's actually a religious war.
So you are aligning with Lai Mohammed that the targets are majorly Christians.
What I am saying is, this is exactly ISWAP's position. That's exactly what they are trying to achieve, and that is exactly what we are doing now, discussing a religious war.
Okay, let me ask you, shouldn't we be discussing the fact that the president less than 3 weeks ago said that Christians are not the target of the Boko Haram sect, terrorists, that's what they are. And then on the other hand, a press conference was held by a representative of this federal government, that's the official spokesperson of the federal government, telling us that Christians are now the target of the Boko Haram sect. Hold on, I'm still coming. The instance that both men are using are the killings on December 24th, 2019. That's the Christmas Eve killing of Adimi. I get that name now. Adimi, yes. Dalip and 11 other Christians.
Okay, so for me, it's a couple of things, right? First of all, let's start with how or what their original goal was, in quotes. They came out and said Western education is a sin. Right? So at that point, it had nothing to do with Christian, Muslim. It was about Western education. But Western education then evolved into anybody that doesn't subscribe to their version of Islam. So that, again, Christians, Muslims, it doesn't matter. And they targeted everybody. So the president was right when he said Christians were not the primary target. These people just target anybody indiscriminately. So he was right in saying that. Now, where I have issues with these sorts of debates is, first of all, I believe Khan has been very irresponsible. I'm a Christian, but personally, I don't believe Khan represents me, because they're supposed to be the Christian Association of Nigeria, but I believe that they've played a huge role in worsening some of the religious divisions in this country. Because when Khan starts to say things like Boko Haram is targeting Christians, sending letters to embassies, nobody is saying that Boko Haram has, nobody's saying Boko Haram is friendly towards Christians. That's not what anybody's saying. Nobody's implying that.
But doesn't it worry you? Yeah. Sorry to interject. Does it? Mm. It's the same presidency.
No, one is speaking
on one side. Yeah. The other is speaking on the same issue. Who do we believe?
So if you look at what the president said then, he wasn't saying they are not targeting Christians. He was saying
that they are not the primary targets.
He's saying that they target everybody.
Mm.
What Lai Mohammed said 2 days ago, yesterday, was that Boko Haram have changed tactics from not targeting just Christians to now intentionally targeting Christians because they want this debate to shift into a religious debate. I don't really think it's a contradiction because they're saying two different things. But they're talking about two different scenarios or two different situations. So the president was right when he said that, even though personally I had an issue with him even saying that in the first place, or the presidency rather, because I don't believe that the presidency should be having this sort of debate in the first place. Because when Boko Haram kills anybody, Christian, Muslim, atheist, it doesn't matter. Somebody has died or people have died. It shouldn't matter what religion they come from. That is somebody that's that. That's somebody's father, mother, cousin, uncle, friend. It makes no difference to the loved ones of that person. If Boko Haram is targeting Christians or targeting Muslims, they have a dead relative, they have a dead friend. So that's why I had an issue with the president even joining Khan to have that sort of debate in the first place, which is why I said, one of the reasons I said Khan, in my opinion, has been quite irresponsible. There was a terrorist attack, I think it was last week, in Borno State, where Boko Haram killed quite a few people on a road. I think the Nigerian army had closed the road going into, I think they closed it at 5 p.m. Some people were trapped outside the gates. Boko Haram attacked them. And Khan released a statement saying that the Christian Association of Nigeria officials were actually the targets of that attack. Now, to me, that's one of the most irresponsible statements that any religious organization can ever make. Because first of all, let's even assume, first of all, I don't believe that was what it was. I think it was an opportunistic attack because they saw the number of people that were trapped there and they took advantage and they knew the army wasn't there. But let's even say it's true that Khan officials were the targets. Why on earth would you come out and say that? What purpose does that serve? Because the minute you're saying that, you're starting to feed into their propaganda, like he said, and turning this thing into a religious debate. And it's a very unfortunate debate because most right-thinking Muslims don't believe that those Boko Haram people are even, because they certainly don't represent Islam. I have Muslims in my family. And I'll tell you for free that these people do not represent. I have Muslim friends.
But doesn't
they it is
worrying to a lot of persons that it is too seemingly contradictory, because to the layman, you're speaking from a very enlightened position, right? The layman on the street is, what did he say? What didn't he say? And that's why we're having this kind of conversation
the media needs to be accurate in how they report these things. Because
so what was that? Let me ask Olalekan. Was that press conference then really necessary? Because he says that in spite of what the noise that has been made in the media, that the government is actually winning the war against the insurgents. And that is why they are trying to change the narrative to make it into a religious war, to get Christians to, you know, tag into it. If they really are winning the war, and this is a strategy of the
ISWAP
and Boko Haram, why then was that press conference necessary? Wouldn't it be feeding, like you said, into the agenda of the same people you're trying to win out?
Now, Felicity, this war is on two fronts, on the military front and on the propaganda front. That is how this kind of war is fought. Now, what is happening is that, now, when the matter started, let us go back to the background. The U.S. released, I think, Department of State released a statement about Christian persecution in Nigeria, that, Christians were being persecuted, and Khan came up in a follow-up to take a position with the U.S. government, which I think Femi Adesina responded to on channels, that it can't be a situation where Boko Haram is actually attacked, because that's the main content of the reports issued by the U.S. The Department of State at the time. So in that situation, so what I think Femi Adesina was trying to do at the time was to downplay the idea that, oh, it's actually this Christian persecution going on in Nigeria. That's what he was trying to achieve. I'm trying to really read his mind now. Now, this now this current statement from Lai Mohammed is just trying to say, okay, this government is winning the war, which any government will say anyway. But what they are, Boko Haram is changing strategy to make the war look a little bit difficult by bringing religion into it. I get my point now, because it becomes very, very difficult if you make this a religious war than what it was before. Do you understand what I'm saying? Making it look like, oh, it's a Muslim Christian, which actually ISWAP, the Islamic State of West Africa, actually wants. Do you understand what I'm trying to make it a little more difficult, to make it a little more more complicated?
Bringing religion. Press conference, has it been able, in your opinion, to address this seeming
No, unfortunately it hasn't, because first of all, I don't think the press conference was necessary, even though I understood what he was trying to say. But to me, it's a ridiculous debate to even be having, who's died more, Christians or Muslims. It's just a silly debate, in my opinion. And If anyone is to blame for this, first of all, the government should be above these kinds of conversations, first of all, because you're the government of the country. You're not the government of Christians or of Muslims. You're the government of the country. So you shouldn't even be having that kind of debate. Now, Khan has a duty, or is supposed to have a duty, to protect the rights of the rights and the rights of Christians. But I've not seen anything in the last 3-4 years that Khan has done that I would say that they're actually protecting the rights of Christians in certain things that they do. Because and it's not just Khan, to be fair, it's Khan, it's Murik, the Muslim rights. Personally, I don't believe they represent the rights of Muslims either. As far as I'm concerned, Khan and Murik are two sides of a very bad coin. And so they do these things, and both groups, in my opinion, have done more to damage religious cohesion in Nigeria than most of the activities. So when they start having this, when they start fueling these kinds of silly debates about who has Boko Haram killed more Christians, it's ridiculous.
So what narrative should be on the ground, quickly, in 30 seconds? Let me have your thoughts on it.
First of all, the government must intensify its clampdown, and it's we must get rid of this sect once and for all. Let's just any way to.
It
it's not
seems
a question.
To be no, it's, and
it seems to be
themselves.
Because now we are now even having a more malignant ISWAP to deal with. You know, that is one.
Your strategy.
Yeah.
What kind of conversation should we be having, as against you saying this kind of religious divide conversation is not necessary? The government shouldn't be taking part of it. The Christians and the Muslims shouldn't also be acting the way they're acting. What kind of conversation do you advocate?
For me, it's you deal with it the way you deal with terrorist situations. There's the military angle. There's the softer angle, which is the people part of it. That's what they should be doing. And more than anything else, there's the perception problem that this government has. And they need to stop saying things like Boko Haram has been defeated, technically defeated. And those, because when you say those things and then you hear of another attack, you start to wonder, what is the government talking about? So they need to stop saying things like that, because it creates a very bad perception.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
For coming on the program, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Your thoughts are appreciated. And of course, thank you for staying with us. We'll take our plot report now, and when we return, I'll be giving my take. Stay with us.
Residents of Oke Oroma community in Edo State have called on the state government and the Oba of Benin to come to their aid over continuous attacks from neighboring Amagba community. They said the recent attack, which occurred a few days ago, has left about 6 persons dead, including an 86-year-old man, with several buildings destroyed. They added that the neighboring community invaded their village with over 200 armed youths. They have called for the intervention of the government and the Oba of Benin to prevent an escalation.
The Amagba people came with their weapons They drove all, we all away from this community. They started shooting AK. People, they chat, they rent from Kogi. And themselves, Abraham Agbasoke, Matthew Duakeme, brought all those hoodlums to our village to come and start burning every houses, destroying every property. We all ran away. As they get here, as you can see this summit now, it's for me and my family. It is where I get money. I used to train my children in the school. I do come from Benin. I meet my people here. Then we say, the shimo wood that we bought here, worth almost 1.8 million. We just brought wood, not quite 2 days. Then the fight came. They burned the whole wood now, as you can see. This is the machine that we used to saw 1x2 or 1x3, the way they used to, the way people want it. And some of my vehicle, look at my vehicle. You see it now? That's the wood we used to carry plank to people in the site. They burn my shade now. Me, I'm helpless now. So I'm begging the government. I am begging the Omonoba Nedo, Oba Ewaye the second, to come to call my people in.
Having walked outside, I'm preparing to come home and develop and join my people in their development strikes. But I came and met war. Remember, we don't ever rest, we don't have this. 2019 here. Peter Rewe, otherwise called Yellow Man, led a team. He shot at one of the villagers, called Sazen. He shot him at the back with the intention of killing him. The matter had been reported to the police. 17th March 2018, Lamba Youth, or Atlas CDA, came to Okoroma community with no less than 30 people, with surveyors, patrol jeeps, to survey our community. 26th March, Ababa came, same 2018. Ababa came with CDAs armed with machetes and offensive weapons from the surrounding villages, namely Obazabu, Egbire, Okoromi, Umuoke, numbering over 200. This is an outright invasion without warning. This sort of thing will lead to breakdown of law and order. I've advised our armed youth to maintain peace and avoid war or open competition.
There is a marked improvement from the sad days of the Ebola outbreak. We have made some really commendable strides in preparing for such emergencies since then. Tonight, I will not bash or complain because we all can see that efforts are ongoing, whatever our opinion might be as to how well there are efforts by the government. I wish only to caution on the importance of not spreading fear and fake news about the coronavirus that has finally arrived in Nigeria. A well-known public affairs commentator, Zeal Akariwe, tweeted this morning a reminder that more people died from their stupidity in avoiding Ebola using salt than those Ebola actually killed. So I urge calm. By all means, get informed and take all the necessary precautionary measures listed by the Ministry of Health. Thank you for watching the program tonight. We will see you again on Monday. Until then, do follow Plus TV Africa programs live on Star Times channels 308 or 508 and online via website or YouTube. Bye for now. Take care.